So our next speaker is going to be Dr. Scott Grantham, who's the medical director for the Laureate Psychiatric Hospital and Clinic.
Hello. Well, thank you. Thank you for that welcome. I'm very pleased to be here, very excited to be here, honored to be a part of such a distinguished panel. I'm going to try to keep a brisk pace because I'm excited about taking some questions. Also there are some far more important people than me behind me who probably have busy schedules today. So I will try to get through this in a way that is both helpful to you, but also pretty concise. So I want to talk to you today about not the science surrounding the issue, but about just the day-to-day practical considerations that we face under this new way of doing things. And not because I think I have all the answers, or even maybe any of the answers, but because I hope that if all stakeholders in this new paradigm can just recognize these challenges and can understand their complexity, then maybe we can be a bit more patient with or less prone to frustration with each other as these details get ironed out. So we're going to look at this from three different perspectives, the first being the perspective of a hospital administrator, the second being the perspective of a clinic director, maybe a lead partner in a group of physicians, and the third being from the perspective of a rank and file frontline physician. So first, let's talk about hospitals and the physicians that practice there. When this initiative was passed, most of the conversation at hospitals revolved around what are we going to do to accommodate these new rules? What are we going to do to respond to this development? And the most obvious question that comes to mind is, what are we going to do about patients who have a license for medical marijuana when they come to our hospital to get treatment? And so medical marijuana doesn't, of course, and no one would ever suggest this, make you immune to any of the other maladies that can affect us. You're still going to have individuals who get injured in some way, have a heart attack, have a stroke, and need hospitalization, and perhaps their medical marijuana usage is for a condition, a chronic condition that is incidental to the reason that they're being admitted for acute medical care in a hospital, but it still has to be addressed. At the health system where I work, there was a series of meetings to address these types of concerns. One thing I want to explain about how hospitals make decisions is all medications or other therapies and their use and their approval tends to be routed through a specialized committee. At most places, it's called the Pharmacy and Therapeutics Committee. At other places, it might be called something else, but there's essentially a set governing body for what kind of treatments are allowed at the hospital as a gatekeeping type of service. And one of the core functions of that body is to maintain a hospital formulary. That's a list of medications that are allowed to be used at the hospital. And that formulary list also directs the hospital pharmacy to acquire and maintain an adequate supply of those medications. So that was the first issue that came up as we thought about addressing these developments. It quickly became apparent that medical marijuana, because of this new paradigm, this new way of doing things, was not going to fit into the usual types of categories available in our formulary. The most obvious example of which would be that it's not specifically FDA approved for a condition. And so if it's not going to be included into your formulary like some other type of medicine, then the next question you have to answer is, then what will you do with the marijuana that patients present with on campus or their request to continue using while they're in the hospital? So that's a very difficult question to think through. A lot of different facets to that, it almost always necessitates some plan, some kind of policy for offering the patients a way for any supply that they have with them to be securely stored so that it can be safely returned to them upon discharge. Fortunately, we already have a process in place because patients are in the habit of bringing medications to the hospital, some of which might be controlled substances themselves, and so this exists. And so that part was a bit easier figure out than some of these larger questions, but that's something that each health system or hospital has to decide for themselves. Brings up some interesting questions. No policy can address every type of conceivable scenario, but it does bring to mind situations in which maybe a patient would prefer that their supply be sent home for safekeeping, but what if the friend or loved one that accompanied them did not have themselves a license? Is there going to be adequate labeling on the substance for that individual who's willing to volunteer to take on that responsibility to avoid any kind of trouble? Well, I think that's an interesting question for law enforcement or something that might be adjudicated down the line. Next, you think about visitors who have a medicinal marijuana license, and how are you going to respond to potentially their request to take their dosing on hospital property? It seems that the most common strategy for addressing this has become to conceptualize marijuana in the same way that tobacco is conceptualized as far as policies addressing its use on property. And so I expect that you'll notice at most hospital campuses that the tobacco restrictions that have become much of an industry standard will also apply to medicinal marijuana. Of course, much easier to enforce that policy when the marijuana is in smokable form. If somebody takes a small dose of an edible, it's obviously less apparent. And so it's important to realize that these policies, their goal is not to eliminate the use of all tobacco and marijuana on a particular property, but more about just promoting a sense of comfort and wellness amongst patients, visitors, and staff. The next, you have to think of things as a large employer, which all hospitals are, and so how are you going to address staff use and modify your human resources policies? Fortunately, the initiative included some guidance for us here, and we'll look forward to maybe additional guidance from the state legislature in the future. But you can see that you are not to discriminate against a potential employee based upon their status as a license holder unless it would jeopardize participation in or funding from a federal program. I'll touch on that again in a minute because it's more complicated than it sounds. But it also sees that the also says that the holder cannot be sanctioned simply for a negative drug test, but there is a provision for if they're using their medicinal marijuana during work. So any large operation is going to have different employee cohorts, and these different cohorts have to get along and have to understand what one another are doing. What does this look like for the physicians that work at the hospital? Well, physicians may, some, feel uncomfortable with the uncertainty about the objective testing of the use of a patient's marijuana as far as the tests that we have being readily available, being qualitative tests, meaning they just detect the presence or absence of cannabis, but not being useful in a quantitative sense, in that test in and of itself is not going to give you any information about how often or how much someone is using. And that kind of uncertainty is going to affect physicians' willingness to incorporate themselves into the treatment process. Also, physicians who are on the outside of the process looking in may have some doubts about the utility of communicating with the physician that made the recommendation. As we heard in the previous presentation, there's not a required follow-up interval or a mechanism to change or to modify the recommendation. And whether it is true that contacting the physician would have any utility or not, I think it's if it's the physician's perception that it would not have any utility, and that's probably going to influence them in a way that prevents them from doing so. Also, if you think about being a physician that's caring for a patient who has a recommendation from another physician, you will be in a position to address and work with the patient on a alternative therapy if you're responsible for their care in an inpatient setting that does not allow medicinal marijuana. And so what is that going to look like? We don't have an easy replacement strategy or a standard way to respond to any type of discontinuation, type of discomfort that a chronic consumer might have, unlike the way that we have nicotine replacement products that are used so commonly in hospitals that don't allow smoking. Finally, you can see individual practice habits differing amongst different clinicians, and that has probably been the case since the beginning of the medical profession, at least when it started to differentiate into different specialties. And so that's not uncommon, but in addition to simple practice habits, there's also differences in skills or knowledge, and even beyond that, differences in the level of privileging or credentialing or certification that physicians have. And so when you think about a large organization that may have 500, 600 physicians, when you're thinking about policies to enact or guidance to give to those physicians, you have to keep these things in mind because it's not so simple as a one-size-fits-all. You might have a physician covering a patient this week that has the skills and the privileges to manage something like medicinal marijuana, but then their partner that comes on the following week may not share those skills, may not have those privileges. So next, let's look at the clinic perspective and the importance of being consistent and simple. Again, when you have a large operation, it's important that your policies be easily remembered by your organization's members and easy to adhere to. So one very simple problem we encountered early on in conversations about how to respond to this change was, where do we document the use of medicinal marijuana in the medical record? It has become a commonplace for hospitals and health systems to use electronic medical record software. It's far less common for records to be simply handwritten, and so that puts a restriction of some sorts onto how you document, in that much medical documentation now is entering discrete data fields instead of just handwriting the information that you wish to communicate. In most electronic medical record systems, medical marijuana just simply doesn't fit into those discrete data fields that are in the medications section. For instance, it will want you to select a specific molecule or FDA-approved agent name, or maybe a brand name, and a specific dosage and frequency and route of administration. And so that became a barrier to placing medical marijuana information in the medication section. Having a license for medical marijuana is not a condition in and of itself, and so it's not a natural fit into the medical history section, which includes diagnoses like hypertension or COPD, things that an individual experiences, and so that wasn't a very practical option. And then also having a or being a license holder does not constitute having a use disorder, and so there's not much relevance to putting it into the substance abuse or use section. And so although different entities or agencies are likely to solve this problem in different ways, our solution, at least for now, is to include it in the social history, which has for many years in medicine been the most eclectic section, has the most diverse information in it. Currently, the plans are to simply record whether or not the patient reports being a medical marijuana license holder. That's the Planet R health system. I'm not aware of what other systems plan to do about this. Just a few words about medical staff governance. And so Physicians have a tremendous amount of autonomy when practicing as an individual. When they practice in groups, though, there are layers of rules or expectations put upon them, particularly if they're practicing at a hospital, which state law requires to have an organized medical staff. And so you'll see there's, much like government rules, there's medical staff equivalents. There's bylaws that are like the Constitution, and then rules and regulations that are like the laws of the land. But then you have privileging documents, which determine what types of procedures or treatments any individual physician is allowed to provide. But then you have employment agreements if the hospital is actually your employer as well. So each of these have different requirements or expectations put on the physician, and in the build-up to, and even now in the immediate aftermath, these documents are all silent on the issue of medical marijuana, and so it's led to some scrambling on the part of organized medical staffs to try to incorporate this new therapy into our governance. Also, it's not just about rules, but it's also about peer review and performance improvement initiatives. So physicians largely govern themselves in the sense that it is peers that we respond to when we're accused of not just malpractice, but even if there's been a recognized opportunity to improve your practice. And so we have things like, that's not the laser pointer, sorry, here we go. So we have focused professional practice evaluation and ongoing professional practice evaluation. This is when you join a medical staff or if a problem's been recognized by a peer on the medical staff. These are typically a series of cases that are reviewed. Ongoing professional practice evaluation can vary from hospital to hospital, but it's usually done at about a 10-month or 12-month interval, and that's just how the medical staff provides surveillance on itself and its individual members to ensure that they're meeting the standard of care. And then peer review actions, those are things that can be taken as the organized medical staff as a body if it believes that an individual physician is in need of changing some practice habits or gaining some additional education. I mentioned the complexity of federal programs and payments. So the initiative did mention that there's an exception for employing someone with a license to hold medical marijuana if federal funding or participation was jeopardized. But the one comment I have about that is that these are all just examples of different federal payment or federal programs. This is a Medicare payment program. This is another Medicare payment program for physician compensation. CMS standards are a long list of things that hospitals are expected to meet in order to continue to participate in Medicare, which is synonymous with simply being able to conduct business because of the importance of being able to participate in Medicare. But then each commercial insurance program has their own quality initiatives and their own way of rating hospital systems and health systems. And so it is very difficult to actually determine what, if any, federal funding and how much might be jeopardized. And so I think that's led to much of the hesitation on the part of large systems because this is definitely easier to say, but harder to operationalize. And then many health systems have ethical and religious guidelines. So we have two large Catholic health systems in town, and so you also have the influence of those documents or those expectations on what kind of medicine is provided. So I want to end by just talking about some of the sources of confusion and misunderstanding from the perspective of individual frontline physicians. So this, in some ways, has been perceived by physicians as just another program with rules. So I have provided a list here of things that have been enacted in the past 5 or 6 years. Each of these things has a different set of rules or expectations for physicians, some of which include a mechanism for sanctioning a physician if they don't adhere to the program. And so by January 1st of 2020, we'll be required to all have e-prescribing mechanisms for controlled substances, but that requires dual authentication technology, and I could keep going on and on forever, but it's a very technical process. Buprenorphine waivers and methadone waivers. Now that methadone's been around since the 1970s, buprenorphine 1990s, I believe, or year 2000. But those are additional certifications and additional training that you must do if you want to provide those medications to patients. The clozapine, that's an antipsychotic medication that you have to register with a specific website and submit regular lab values to if you want to provide that treatment to patients. Senate Bill 1446 was recently passed and has a variety of different requirements for prescribing opioid medications to patients with acute or chronic pain. And the medical treatment law deals with end-of-life issues, and the prescription monitoring programs, the software database that we are required to check before we provide certain controlled substance prescriptions to patients. And so you can see that it is becoming a lot for physicians to remember and adhere to, and there is some fear that you could inadvertently jeopardize your licensing or otherwise be sanctioned by the state or some other entity like the medical board simply for doing things the traditional way or the way that we learned in medical school and residency, which was simply write the patient a prescription on paper and have them take it to the pharmacy. And then there's the question of what if two physicians disagree? This could become problematic when physicians in the same group who are covering for each other disagree, but it is not, I wanted to just end with a comment that it's not uncommon for physicians to disagree. We've seen this over the years in many different issues. So you can see the cardiologists and OBGYN specialists disagree about estrogen in older females, and the cardiologist will take patients off of it, and the OBGYN will put them back on. And family practice and psychiatry have robust dialogues about certain kinds of sleep aids, and of course the opioid use disorders brought chronic opioid therapy to the forefront. And then I don't know that I've ever seen a neurologist and a neurosurgeon agree on whether or not somebody should be on anti-seizure medicines for a certain period of time. So I think that there's a precedent for this, and I think that there's optimism that these things, as time goes by, can be reconciled. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Dr. Grantham. So I think we'll open it up with questions from the audience. Anybody have a question? Just raise your hand. Any questions? Oh, okay. Yes.
If there's a lot of international research on this, on these topics, how come it's not being quoted in conferences?
By physicians and physician researchers? Well, sure, I think there are robust academic dialogues going on at events like this, maybe to a lesser extent than some other events, but most individual practicing physicians are far removed from the academic dialogues. I mean, they're in the sphere of well-established and mainstreamed treatments because on a day-to-day basis, you see common illnesses that have very common treatment protocols, and so I think there is a distinction between the physicians who are more at the vanguard of this issue and having these debates and more of the frontline medical staffs that you're going to encounter if you go to emergency room or urgent care. And those who are less involved in the debate are anxiously awaiting some clarification, some reconciliation, some guidelines about these things. But I'd say the average physician doesn't want to be the first to do something. You don't want to be the last to do something either, but you want to be squarely in the middle.
Yeah, and I also suspect that some of the research that's being done in Europe and Canada with respect to a cannabis-like compound that a company is making You can look for randomized controlled trials in the research databases, and I would imagine there's more and more of that happening. So I would guess that some of that will arrive over time. Another question that came in related to the town hall. So Dr. Grantham, you're a consultation liaison psychiatrist, so you see a lot of patients in the ER. This may somewhat relate to you. The question was, what do I tell my chronic pain patients regarding the amount or dose of THC to use? Is that a question that sort of comes up often in terms of the emergency room settings, or you see patients who are experiencing chronic pain and ask you that?
We haven't yet, and I think it's because we're waiting on the supply and the distribution to get out there to more commonly encounter that. But it is going to be difficult. I don't know that there's a good analogy for a similar situation in the sense that you may be engaged in a treatment that potentially a majority of physicians would decline to give you a recommendation on. And we all have our limits. I mean, I won't recommend to a patient whether or not they should proceed with their amputation because I'm a psychiatrist and not an infectious disease expert or orthopedic surgeon. But it could be difficult for the patients who choose this therapy to get advice. And that's why I'm interested to see how the follow-up interval develops at clinics that are advertising themselves as specialty clinics for this, because I don't know that you are necessarily going to get it from your primary care physician, at least not at this early stage.
Okay. We'll have time for one question if it's a quick one.
All right, well, about dosing, what I have found is that since we all have a different mitochondria, we're all completely different, and since marijuana and CBD is an herb, that people have to just find out what works for them. You start out low, and if the pain goes away, or if it doesn't go away, you take a little bit more, and then if it continues, then you take a little bit more because you cannot OD on it. And I'm just wondering if you, and I know it's difficult because as doctors, you're used to just having that clinical research as, you know, from a drug perspective, you know, it's all about dosing. And so, I mean, I understand the confusion that physicians are having because this is revolutionary because it's an herb and it's kind of like, almost like taking vitamin C.
And I'm sorry, what is the question?
Well, I did, I just said, did you have difficulty in that perspective? That you're waiting for it to be treated like a drug when really CBD is a supplement and we're all so different. And I know you guys are kind of just catching up to this.
Sure. No, and like I mentioned, you know, we just don't have a good analogy or to put it to. And so everybody's searching for that. But it's not uncommon for physicians to need to find a level of comfort with ambiguity. But that's where the communication between the patient and the physician is so important, because if the patient is asking or expecting specific instructions about something that the physician just isn't knowledgeable about, then that's important to reconcile. The physician needs to explain, like, well, I don't have a specific recommendation for you in that way, but I do have some education to talk to you about. And so there's going to have to be movement, I think, on both sides to more clearly articulate the expectations and capabilities of each, because it is something new and different for doctors, and they just may not be able to give advice in the way that the patients are accustomed to receiving it.
So, yeah, if you think back to that pyramid that Dr. Paulus showed at the beginning, in terms of levels of evidence, you know, as physicians, what you look for is a level of evidence that's at the highest level, which usually comes from a randomized controlled trial. And so the challenge is, if you're going to look at cannabis in the same lens as a pharmacological drug, there's just not yet the infrastructure to have that level of evidence within the U.S. Certainly, we can look to other countries that that allow that type of research, but most of the research, medical research, traditionally has happened between the U.S. and Europe. So the fact that you're not able to conduct this kind of research at a large scale, I think is rather limiting. So we're going to have to move on. We have to stay on schedule for our speakers, but thank you very much, Dr. Grantham. And
thank you all. Thank you.
So in spirit of keeping us on schedule, but also making sure that there is enough time for questions, our last two speakers have agreed to switch order. So it's actually going to be Commissioner White coming out. And then at the very end, it'll be Dr. Clancy. So I'm very pleased to introduce Commissioner White.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for being here this afternoon. Thank you for having me. So, as you heard earlier in the introductions, I'm the Commissioner of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services for the state of Oklahoma. This is my 12th year as commissioner, but I'm a social worker by training. So I'm sandwiched in with three amazing MD psychiatrists, and that means a lot of heavy technical information. So I'm not gonna use slides. I'm gonna talk to you today. We're gonna have a conversation, and we're gonna have a conversation kind of as lay people, because I think, given my two topics, which are substance abuse and public health, I think it's gonna be really important we kind of step back and have that conversation. So the first thing that I wanna talk to you about is to make sure that we all are understanding that there is a real difference in dialogue about what we're having here about cannabis products that contain CBD. So CBD, like the question the woman asked, and when you're up here, you can't see very well, so I'm not pointing exactly at you if you're still here, but kind of your general direction, because I can barely see you all with the lights, but asked the question about CBD and the benefits that she'd seen of CBD versus THC, because these are two components in the plant, a plant that has like 400 components, right? And we actually know very little about most of the components. But I think it's really important as we talk about substance abuse and about public health that we separate these two. And you heard Dr. Beeman talk about it a minute ago. You've heard different speakers touch on it. CBD is the portion of the plant that is non-intoxicating. It's non-intoxicating. This is the portion of the plant that there may be some benefit around sleep, as we heard earlier, around pain, as we heard earlier, around anxiety and other things. And there aren't, as you heard Dr. Beeman answer earlier, there aren't any studies that show using CBD has negative effects. And then there's THC. THC is the portion of the plant that is intoxicating. THC is the portion of the plant that's associated with the negative things you've been hearing earlier, the onset of psychosis and other things that increase in suicidal thoughts, which we know we don't need in Oklahoma, having one of the highest rates of suicide already. So those components can easily be separated. But when we're having these public discussions as we talk about public health, we're not really being always clear, and we're trying to be clear here today, but we're not always clear, and I don't think the public's really clear on the difference between those two things. And so I think that's an important piece of the discussion. So as we move into substance abuse first, which I'm gonna talk about, high content products that have high content THC, the intoxicating part, the part that causes the negative effects that we've been talking about, high content THC, or the higher, and I shouldn't just say high content, the higher you go with your THC content, the more likely you are to have a first need for substance abuse dependent treatment. The higher the content of your THC, the increase the severity is of the marijuana disorder, addiction, and dependence. And make no mistake, THC is absolutely addictive for some people. Absolutely addictive for some people. And I'm gonna talk more about that in just a second. So CBD has not been shown to be addictive. It's non-intoxicating. But THC absolutely can be and is for many Oklahomans already. And so in separating those two things, I think, are a really important piece of the discussion. The second piece as we talk about substance abuse is the discussion about how often THC is used. So a lot of times we just say marijuana. And with marijuana, you do have the THC in it. But I'm not talking about how often you use CBD when I'm talking about this. But the more often you use marijuana with THC in it, or any product with THC in it, the more often you use it, the more likely you are to become addicted. And there is a real difference in marijuana and THC users. Some users use it occasionally, and some users are daily or near daily users. And it makes a big difference in some of the outcomes that I'm talking about as it relates to substance abuse. And so, for example, daily or near daily use of marijuana, THC, for those who use it, is at its highest level, highest level since the early 1980s, which was the highest previously recorded level for our college-age youth. We have much higher levels of daily or near-daily use of THC among our college students. Daily or near-daily use of THC and marijuana is up all ages, all age groups. Their daily or near-daily use of marijuana, if they use, has gone up about 50%. It has doubled since 2002. When you look at marijuana users, more than 2 in 5, almost 2.5, so about half of all marijuana users are daily or near daily users, which means the other half are not near daily or daily users. So what does that mean? And they told me I could move around. Plus, we're after lunch, and I know you guys are getting tired. So one of the things I think sometimes if I can shake it up, maybe you'll pay better attention. So we're going to separate the room in half for just a second. And so this half of the room, you guys are not going to be daily or near daily users. You use marijuana, and you use THC, but you use it occasionally. So your addiction rate, very clearly for THC, if you're not a daily or near daily user, your addiction rate is about 99%. And when I say this, sometimes I say only 9%, and then I catch myself. And I'm like, well, 9% still matters. But just remember, you don't use daily THC, so you're at about 9%. Now, other half of the room. And I'm going to be with you guys. I'll put myself in your group. We are marijuana users, and we use it daily or near daily. Okay? We are daily or near daily users of THC. Do you know what our addiction rate is? In study after study, it's somewhere between 25% and 50%. And most studies show that it hovers around 40%. So how often you use marijuana and how often you use THC really matters. Daily or near daily users have a much higher addiction rate to THC. Their addiction chemistry in their brain is much more likely to come on. So the other thing that matters in this discussion about addiction as it relates to THC is how old our brain is. And if you've heard me talk before, and unfortunately for some of you, you're like, yeah, I've heard you talk many times, right? But if you've heard me talk before, one of the things I talk about a lot is that the prefrontal cortex of the brain is the very last part of the brain to really finish developing. Now, our brain grows and changes our whole life. But the prefrontal cortex is where all of our executive functions are housed, our clinical thinking, our judgment, our logic. And the majority of the development of our prefrontal cortex finishes between the age of 20 and 25. And if we use addictive substances before our prefrontal cortex is developed, our brain is much more likely to chemically lock onto that substance. If we wait and use addictive substances after our prefrontal cortex is fully developed, our brain is much less likely to lock on and become addicted to that substance. They're actually protected that happen. I think I'm moving on them and throwing them off with the mic, sorry. There are actually protective factors that happen in the development of the prefrontal cortex that if you use addictive substances after it's developed for the first time, your addiction circuitry is much less likely to come on. That's why when we talk about alcohol use in our kids who use alcohol for the first time before their prefrontal cortex is developed, so say age 15, are 6 times more likely to become dependent and lock onto that alcohol than youth who wait to the age of 21. So as we talk about addiction as it relates to marijuana and THC, how often we use, no matter our age, whether we're in daily or near daily group versus occasionally, and the age of our brain make a significant difference. So I want you to remember that as we talk about addiction. The other piece that I'm supposed to talk about today is public health. And as we talk about public health, I think one of the most important things to think about, and for those of you that aren't really familiar with public health means how we protect the public. So some examples of important public health legislation in the last 50 years. Seatbelts, one of the most important public health laws we have, requiring people to wear seatbelts. Preventing youth from drinking alcohol, setting the drinking age at 21, one of the most important public health pieces we have. All kinds of issues. Regulating restaurants, food safety. You heard earlier one of the speakers talking about that cannabis and marijuana, unlike other medical products, can grow mold and other things, and how are you going to handle contamination? So those are considerations when we talk about public health. When we talk about public health, we have to think about smoking in public places, right? Oklahoma, as we know, was a latecomer to the game of saying we don't have smoking in public places because of the public health risks. But we know that's an important piece. So as we talk about public health as it relates to THC, to marijuana, to CBD, to all of these products, one of the things that I think is really important, if we go on the micro level of public health, is knowing what we know about the age of the brain, and that if we're younger when we use this product, we're more likely to become addicted. How are we going to create public health laws or regulations that protect our kids? One, we should not have packaging that's attractive to kids. There should be no cartoon characters. There should not be slogans and advertisements with things that are bright colored and those types of things that really appear to kids, right? As adults, we're kind of boring. And we'll read labels and we'll still buy things if it's in a plain black and white package. So I think making sure that we don't market or have things that are attractive to kids becomes really important. Are we going to have a symbol on the package that lets people know there's actually THC in it? We should have a universal symbol, if we're talking about public health, that when you see that symbol, and it can't be the symbol we have now, because the symbol we have now, right, across the state that you've seen popping up almost on every street corner, the green kind of cross-looking symbol, none of us know if that means CBT or THC or marijuana, right? So what's going to be the universal symbol for the addictive product of this, the THC? Because that needs to be in there. Because here's the thing. We heard the question earlier was such a good question because it was about a much older Oklahoman, or maybe she wasn't living in Oklahoma, I wasn't sure by the question, who was using CBD, the non-intoxicating part. Well, if you were living in Oklahoma 6 months ago and had access to CBD or 8 months ago, what if now all of a sudden your product has THC in it and it's intoxicating and you don't even know it because there's no universal symbol and it's not labeled? So when we talk about public health, that's another really important piece. The other thing we've got to put on these labels, what's the concentration of THC in the product versus the concentration of CBD? CBD not intoxicating, the positive effects we were talking about earlier, should be high, right? THC, the higher you get, the more likely you are to have all those negative consequences we just talked about, including addiction, should be low. But we don't even have a requirement in our state right now, like most states do, to say, we're going to at least tell you the percent of THC and CBD in the product that you're looking at. That's got to be an important piece of public health. For the public wants to take responsibility for their health, and they should, but they have to be given the information about what's in the product they're looking at. Advertising. One of the biggest things for advertising, and when you talk about public health, is how you advertise, where you advertise. First, not advertising for products. Let's talk about alcohol for a second, just so you see what I mean. Alcohol advertisements shouldn't be targeted at 15-year-olds, right? They should be targeted at adults. We've got to make sure that our advertising for this, knowing what we know about young brains, isn't targeted at kids. And as importantly, if not more importantly, we cannot have false information in our advertising. We should be required, just like we are with any other medical product, to have to put true information. You heard Dr. Beeman talking earlier, and I thought one of the most important points he made, for a state that is already overrun with opioid overdoses, although we are making progress and we are moving down the ladder, which is great, the fact is that the research is pretty clear that use of THC increases the likelihood that you will have the subsequent onset of an opioid use disorder. So when we market things, are we telling the truth in the advertising or not? That becomes a really important piece of public health discussion. And finally, on public health, in terms of what one of the things that needs to happen is a public health information campaign. Everybody in Oklahoma, and I say everybody, not everyone, but so many Oklahomans are darn confused right now about what's going on. And with other things, there are public health campaigns and information campaigns that share that information. So people know about the discussion we just had about CBD versus THC. All of that information, because everybody's shelves are changing right now, and the public is not getting good information or being educated about it, and that has to happen if we're talking about public health. So the last thing that I want to say as I talk about public health, and I'm happy to take any questions, is that public health also happens out of the state capitol. And right now, because you've heard several speakers allude to it, but I don't know if anybody was really clear with you about what this means. So the state question passed, And what that means is that the contents of the state question are now in state statute. What is happening right now at the Capitol, and if you followed any of the lots of things that were happening over the summer with these rules and regulations and what was in statute, what was in rules, there was a whole lot of discussion about what public health measures could be instituted given the way the state question was written. And it's not very many given the way the state question was written. But what was clear and what the Attorney General has said is that the statute absolutely can be changed. And right now what the legislature is considering is what should that statute look like? And anything can be on the table. Now, do I think that they're going to change it and that we're not going to have marijuana in the state? Absolutely not. That is not going to happen. It passed overwhelmingly. But what is happening right now, and if you haven't followed this, is that the marijuana industry, the growers, the sellers, the dispensaries, they have gotten together in a pretty big group, and they've developed a bill that's about 250, maybe more, pages of what they want the statute to look like. Okay? And there are some things in that bill that I think all of us can agree with. But it's also written from that perspective. And one of the things that as those of us that work in public health, in the medical community, in mental health, in substance abuse, are saying, and I think is an important discussion to have, is what else should be in that legislation to protect public health and to decrease the chances that we're going to have people using high-content THC with low-content CBD? What should be in there to address those issues and to try to prevent addiction and to prevent an increase in people thinking about suicide or attempting suicide and to try to do all of those things? And so I think it's really critical that if this is an issue you care about, that you realize it's here to stay. I really believe that. But that right now is when the real skeleton is going to be built of what this is going to look like in our state. And in Oklahoma right now, we are the Wild West when it comes to medical marijuana. There is no other state that has a law like this. There is no other state that doesn't have some form of public health regulation in their statute. And we really have to remember that if we're a state that cares about the health of our people, and I know that we are, that we're going to ensure there is some balance between how we do this to both protect public health, increase access to CBD, decrease access to THC, and make sure that we approach this from a perspective, from my position of what we're talking about, that prevents addiction and increases public health. Thank you very much. I just gave you back so much time.
Physicians really appreciate it. Physicians always talk longer.
Now, I know Dr. Clancy won't because he's a rock star, but we were talking backstage and he said, everybody's going longer. I said, I'll make up the time. So there you go.
Much obliged. Okay, questions?
Thank you. This is an opinion question. Why do you think our government is so much more interested in controlling cannabis than it is alcohol?
Well, so part of this, I'm going to ask you a question back. I'm curious why you think the government is our government. And first of all, I can't answer for government. I am not a legislator. I'm not the governor. So I don't get to make laws, right? That's not how this works. So I'm curious why you think what perspective it comes from. I know it's the topic right now, but we have by far hundreds more statutes on alcohol than we have on cannabis. So I'm not sure I understand the question of what makes you think the government is more interested in regulating cannabis than alcohol right now. And I'm not saying you're wrong. Please don't misunderstand me. I just am not sure I understand the question.
It was my understanding from earlier presentations that research is being limited by the government by making it a
Schedule I drug. So what you're talking about is that the federal government has it as a Schedule I drug. I really don't know how to answer you why the federal government has it as a Schedule I drug, only in the sense that I am a state official and my career is working at the state level. So that would be like if I turned around, I'm going to assume for 1 second you all live in Tulsa, and I'd say to you today, hey, why is Oklahoma City doing this? I don't know how to answer the question for you about what the federal government does, but I understand what you're saying about Schedule I drugs and research. Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me, we have a question over here.
Oh, sorry.
Right over here.
It's really hard to see up here.
You present information about cannabis.
Are you talking about CBD or THC or both?
Both.
Okay.
You know, a lot of the presentations kind of said cannabis as if it was all one thing.
Right, that's the part I'm trying to say.
Which is unfortunate.
Right.
And the scheduling actually happened when Nixon, by executive order, went against the doctors in 1970, against the Schaefer Commission. So I think the question we're trying to ask is, you know, Dr. Beeman wanted more control, but the physicians have given up control because they have never gone up and said, you know, why is Nixon deciding that this should be Schedule One? If you looked at the actual harm versus the potential benefits,
Tell me what your question is of me. I'm so sorry.
You know what? Because you're.
What are you? What is it you're asking me?
Right. I think that all of us have a responsibility, whether we're a state employee or a legislator or a patient, to go further than just, well, I don't know. I'm not involved with the federal government. I don't know why they're scheduling Schedule One. You know, here methamphetamine being Schedule Two and cannabis One, I'm like, we have a responsibility to take care of that.
I understand what you're saying, but I'm not going to be able to answer for the federal government here today. I'm sorry,
right,
I just
can't.
Right,
but some of the physicians have said, well, the federal government says it's Schedule One, so we can't study it, and that absolves me of having to even consider prescribing it.
I thought what I heard here today was a lot of people talking about the need to be able to do more research, but I can't answer for anyone else, and I can't answer for the federal government. It is a Schedule One drug, and I'm happy to talk to you about anything related to Oklahoma public health or Oklahoma substance abuse today.
We have a question over here. I'm also just going to make one quick comment in terms of the concept of drugs of abuse that are on a different schedule is really intended at a federal level to try to prevent harm to the population. And that if you look at the way that drugs are currently scheduled, you can see a number of other drugs for which there's actually research happening. This is the Cannabis Summit. But there's actually research happening on other substances looking at potential salutary effects. For example, in psychiatry, you know, depression is a big problem and suicide, and ketamine, which is a Schedule III drug, is currently a hot topic. A lot of people, there are a lot of actual randomized trials that are emerging suggesting some positive effects on suicidality in that particular substance. So I think ultimately what we need is better research, and we need the ability to do that research. And whether it happens in this country or whether it happens sort of in other countries, ultimately we do need sort of those highest quality markers of evidence.
Yeah,
so
we have to be doing evidence-based medicine, and certainly as it relates to state resources, we have to be spending dollars on practices we know that are cost-effective and have good outcomes. Medicine is a science. I mean, we should be using evidence-based services. I say this all the time, particularly in the world of mental health and substance abuse, where there's so much stigma and confusion about what these brain diseases really are. There is a whole lot of very clear evidence in medical science, and that's what we should be utilizing as treatments as it relates to mental health and substance abuse. Yes, sir?
Yeah, I think we have a unique opportunity. I mean, we talked about the different levels of evidence, but we have a unique opportunity now that the legal status has changed, that there will be possibly different patterns of use. Are you looking at it from a state side to monitor mental health and substance use problems sort of pre-post? And looking at what changes you're seeing? And
we're looking at everything what we're going to need to monitor in the state. And for our stuff, that will be easy because we have a really good public mental health and substance abuse data system. We actually have one of the best in the United States. But there are definitely gaps. You've heard some today of other data collections in the state that, for example, if this information going to be, are we going to know, is this collected? And so to do health research, we need to be very comprehensive. But one of the things we're also doing is we're watching a lot of the clinical trials that do exist. There's a trial right now in New Mexico, because one of the things I kept hearing over the last several months is we need this for PTSD. Well, again, CBD has potential for a lot of positive effects. THC has a lot of negative effects. There is no evidence that THC is at all good for PTSD. We know it increases anxiety. So it's very concerning to look at what might happen as it relates to PTSD, but there's a really good, big study happening in New Mexico right now that everybody's sort of waiting on the edge of their seat, and it's actually targeted at veterans. And so we're very anxious to see what the outcome is so that we can base our recommendations and our medicine on that. If it shows it has positive effects, we need to know it. If it shows it has negative effects and exacerbates symptoms, we need to know it. And so we definitely need more very clear research.
Okay. I think it's 3:05, so do you want to take another question?
I will take one more question.
Okay, this woman over here had raised her hand earlier. Do you still have a question?
I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for the courage to be present. I want to thank you, Dr. Clancy, for the courage to address this topic. I want to thank you, LIBOR. I want to thank you, Warren Foundation. I want to thank you, Laureate. I want to thank you, TU. I want to thank you, OU. It's with gratitude that we're all here. Thank you, Terry.
Oh, thank
you. Well, thank you. No question there, but we'll allow it. Okay, it's my pleasure to introduce our next and final speaker for today, Dr. Jerry Clancy, the president of the University of Tulsa.
my thanks as well to the Warren Foundation and to LIBOR and to the LIBOR team for putting this on and having the courage to talk about this. So my story, I'm going to talk about how we're educating our physician workforce on this. And it's been a very interesting past 6 months or so on that. It was in September or so, I was teaching over at the OUTU School of Community Medicine. I teach a class on health disparities in community medicine. And the students came to me and said, and these are second year students, can you give us a lecture on marijuana? We don't understand it at all, and we know what we're heading into. And we're not getting it in any of our physiology classes or pharmacology classes or anything like that. And so I started putting together a 2-hour short course for the medical students, and I gave it to them, and it went really well. And they told the first years and the third years and the fourth year medical students, so they asked, so I did it again for them. And then they told the OSU Medical School, and I did it for them. And next week I'm off to Notre Dame to do it as well. So and with a high of 5 degrees in South Bend, which is just going to be great. And when I start my short course, I start out by saying that anytime you start talking about marijuana, you are going to have an emotional conversation. It's emotional for everybody. It's emotional for the patient. It's emotional for the physicians. It's emotional for the business that is happening. It's emotional for law enforcement. It's emotional for the legislators. You cannot really hardly ever have a conversation that is pretty boring about marijuana. And I let the students know, first and foremost, you need to realize that 85% of Americans want availability of medical marijuana. And so that's your starting point. Our patients that we take care of have been voting with their feet. This is a dispensary in Pueblo, Colorado, which would be right here. And they ask the question, when you're at the marijuana dispensary, tell us where you're from. Well, this is Oklahoma, right here. And so, and you see a huge amount of people before 788 was passed traveling to Pueblo, Colorado for marijuana. So it is highly emotional. And it's emotional among patients in part because they're frustrated. They're frustrated with the medical system not being able to care for certain conditions or caring for conditions that lead them into pathways that they didn't want to go to, such as opioid addiction and stuff. So it's highly, highly emotional that way. And it's emotional for the cities. How we have orchestrated taxation of marijuana business has now led to a dependence of cities and states on that revenue now. If you look at Colorado now, it's $1 billion a year industry. And some of the little towns in Colorado were saved by marijuana as well. Oakland wants to be the Silicon Valley of pot. So it just shows that it is small town business, and it's big town business as well. There are now stocks that you can buy on the Canadian market that are focused on marijuana. And Coca-Cola and Marlboro and Constellation Brands, which is a group of beer companies, very, very interested in CBD and THC as well. So it is emotional at that business level as well. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about the state of medical education in America on marijuana, and then I'm gonna give you just a few snippets of the course that I developed for the students and just comment on what some of their reactions have been to some of those points. So in this study, 258 residents and fellows were surveyed about marijuana. And 89% felt that they were not prepared to prescribe medical marijuana. And 85% had not had any education on medical marijuana as well. So that was with one survey. And it was repeated again when they asked the medical school deans, how are you doing as far as medical marijuana? And so this is 101 medical schools. That's about two-thirds of the medical schools in America right now responded. 67% of the deans said their graduates are not prepared to prescribe medical marijuana. And that 25% of their trainees really don't know anything about marijuana as well. So those are pretty damning numbers as far as what the physicians are heading into. Across Canada, where legalization has been more established, 426 physicians were asked about their knowledge of medical marijuana. And they really had significant knowledge gaps in dosing. Dosing was number one. They have no idea as far as what dosing is. They don't know about the different forms of the cannabis. They do not understand the regulations, and they do not understand the safety risks and warning signs. So we're really starting from scratch as far as where physicians are. Now, we talked earlier about research, and Cy made a really important point, and Martin made a very important point at the beginning as well, that pyramid. That pyramid is really a pyramid of trust for physicians as far as what they do for their patients as far as trying to help them. And the higher up in that pyramid, the more the physician has trust that this treatment is proven and going to do well for someone. Well, marijuana has been around for 6,000 years, but in the age of modern medicine, it has not been researched. And so that level of trust among physicians is just not there because we haven't done the research going forward. 311 pharmacy students were asked about marijuana, and what they found out is that they were low in accurate responses for diseases and conditions that might benefit from marijuana. They only endorsed cancer and glaucoma as the conditions that marijuana would be considered. 13% noted that they received some instruction on medical marijuana while they were in pharmacy school, and 90% felt they needed more instruction as well. So the state of education for our emerging clinicians needs additional help. So this is the short course that I've developed. It takes about 2 hours to go through, lots of engagement back and forth with the students. It's divided into 5 parts. We start with the biochemistry of cannabis and neurotransmitter systems. This is really important as far as building trust with physicians as well. Physicians are geared to understand the biology first before they will ever do anything as far as treatment. They want to know the physiology, the biochemistry, in the molecular biology at a deep level. They do not want to be working in mystery territory. So they ask a lot of questions about that. Then I go into recommendations and not indications. We go into risks, we go into legal implications, and then we go into the detail as far as making a marijuana recommendation. The objectives of the course are to really understand the emerging neuroscience. The endocannabinoid system was discovered really in 1992. I had never heard of it when I was in medical school. Anandamide, which is the primary neurotransmitter that THC mimics, I had never heard of until I started doing some of this just investigation into this short course. We talk about where and when have marijuana compounds been helpful to patients. We talk about the growing concerns, and you heard a lot about that today, on the impact of heavy marijuana use on that developing brain in uncovering psychosis and in essentially kickstarting a vulnerability for schizophrenia, which is a very, very serious condition. We go into the understanding the legal issues regarding making a recommendation and the role of a physician in making a recommendation. I'm just going to show you some sample slides that we go through. We start with the chemistry part of it, and I want them to realize that marijuana is a highly complex compound. 426 chemicals so far discovered in it. 60 of them are psychoactive. 2 of them do we have much understanding as far as how they work. So it's very much a mysterious new emerging science as far as understanding the endocannabinoid system that is where marijuana, where THC and CBD do their work. The students are also fascinated in the legal aspects part of this. And I'm going to show you just one of the areas that they get highly emotional, all physicians get highly emotional on, is the fact that it is class one controlled substance alongside bad boys like heroin and ecstasy and LSD. So that gets everybody's pulse up right away. We go into the difference between prescribing and recommending, because this is important as far as the federal interpretation of what a physician can and can't do. A prescription is an order to a patient and to consume a controlled substance and an order to a pharmacist to prepare and distribute the substance. That's a prescription. Issuing such an order for a class one controlled substance is aiding or abetting a crime or a conspiracy to violate a federal offense. That's why physicians get nervous about this, obviously. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals in 2002 and 2003 made the following interpretations, though, and the U.S. Supreme Court has refused to hear an appeal. They said recommending the use of cannabis for medical purposes is permitted. Indeed, it is protected. An integral component of the practice of medicine is the communication between a doctor and a patient. Physicians must be able to speak frankly and openly to patients, and such speech strikes at the fundamental interest behind the First Amendment. So you can't prescribe because it's a controlled substance, but you can recommend because it's free speech. That's the logic. So in making a recommendation, I break it down into nuts and bolts for our students. A physician may discuss treatment options, including cannabis, discuss the pros and cons of treatment with medical cannabis, recommend that a patient consider use of medical cannabis to offset symptoms, and sign a form to that effect. That's recommending. But a physician may not order a patient to consume medical cannabis, may not provide instructions about the amount to consume, because that would be prescribing. Provide instruction on the form in which medical cannabis must be taken, because that would be prescribing. And order that medical cannabis be prepared or distributed to the patient, because that is prescribing. I was in California this summer as I was running down the beach at Venice Beach. And I was really kind of after this, I'm smiling. I thought, I got to take a picture of this. This is interesting. Green doctors, $40. As soon as I took this picture, somebody came out in green scrubs just begging me to go in. Come on in, come on in, come on in. It'll only take 10 minutes. We can get you some marijuana. I'm not a California resident. No, we'll work it out. My shirt says Tulsa on it right here. I mean, I've got a twang even. I mean, but it was really, it's as we think about the future of Oklahoma, we can't fall to this level. We can't. It is. And it is so important. Yeah, it really, really is. This was what was on the door. Do you suffer from migraines, insomnia, eating disorders, anxiety, depression, chronic pain, glaucoma, nausea, arthritis, AIDS, ADD, ADHD, cancer, or many other disorders? We just can't do this. We can't go there with this. And that's really, Dr. Grantham. Dr. Grantham mentioned about all those rules and regulations and oversight and bylaws alongside a physician. This is going to be important as we head into this, that we are still following the best standard of practice out there. The Tampa Bay Times put out this report earlier this year, and it's something that we need to watch for in Oklahoma. What it looked at is the physicians in their medical marijuana program. And there was a group of physicians, a higher percentage than across the board in Florida, that were more likely to have been disciplined and more likely to have charges of crime as well. So we can't have the medical marijuana clinics fall into this level of care or at all. We've just got to make sure we keep those standards up there. All right, I think that's it. I think I'm done. I'm done. We're done. All right, thanks.
All right, thank you, Dr. Clancy. So in spirit of the town hall meeting, well, I guess the question, there were two questions for you that were submitted by one person. The first one I think you answered. What is the status today of teaching medical students about cannabis at the OUTU School of Medicine? But the second one, what are the plans for the future?
So I think it's, you know, that's why I showed those first few slides, that it is here. And physicians, you're in the middle of it by way of legislation and public vote. This is not the traditional way that a treatment is developed in America as far as drug trials and then introduction and then lots of CME. Instead, it's just here. Here it is. So there's a huge amount of catching up that has to be done. And it's interesting that there's not a whole lot of expertise out there as well, because again, we haven't had, during modern medicine, the research time to be able to develop it. So the foundation of knowledge that physicians are going to accept as of the quality that they want is pretty low.
So do you see the quality of medical education on marijuana improving in the state of Oklahoma in the years ahead?
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Questions from the audience. This woman right here. Yep. Oh, wait for the microphone.
It's Ryan.
Hi, Dr. Clancy.
Ryan.
Great presentation. What do we do in the short term? Because obviously there's demand. We have all the major systems not prescribing this. How do we prevent those types of doctors being the types of doctors that write these prescriptions?
Yeah, I think, you know, at first there was a lot of groaning about the board certification requirement, but the board certification requirement is really important. To be able to maintain your board certification status, it's regularly tested, you're regularly evaluated, so at least there's somewhat of a safety net there. But Rania, I'm learning as we're learning.
Question at the front.
Obviously, we're just at the beginning of teaching doctors. What about teaching nurses that support the physicians? I'm in a family practice. We have chronic pain patients. I need this knowledge as much as the physician writing the prescription because I'm his support in the clinic. What's being done to support the other healthcare ancillary providers?
I'll ask Dr. Schumann, who has a bigger health science college than I do. Anything, John, that you know of? You know yet.
No.
Yeah.
Did you want a mic?
Okay. Other questions? Great. In the back, way in the back.
Gotcha.
Dr. Clancy, is there a way for us to access your lecture?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Because it's not on YouTube. I just ran a search.
You know, in part, I have a lot of people have asked for it, and in part because it is so emotional, and I want the delivery to be in the right context that I've not published yet. Maybe that's the next thing I need to do is try to figure a way that we can publish it. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you collect surveys of the students before and after the class?
We do. Okay. It goes from, you know, all I get is 5 stars.
Question over here.
I have a question about what we know about drug-drug interaction with the other medications that are being given for our common comorbidities.
Yeah. Again, we're still at that starting point as far as any research, because research in the past of this in general has been just so restricted because it's class one, and so no one's touched it. We do know that in the era where a lot of supplements were used alongside traditional psychiatric medications, lots and lots of trouble with that. Lots of trouble. That someone, just because it said all natural and it was a supplement and it was a store, somebody thought, oh, this is fine. Well, that is very powerful psychoactive stuff, supplement that you're trying to treat your depression with alongside your Prozac, and people were having terrible reactions.
I mean, One question that I have related to cannabis is in terms of what are potential populations where there might possibly be an interesting effect. So I work with eating disorders patients, mm-hmm. and these are patients who self-induce weight loss and really have a fundamental shift in how they respond to appetite in their hypothalamus, which has cannabinoid receptors. And so prior to this meeting, I was looking to see, is there any evidence that cannabis might actually help improve weight gain, prevent weight loss, and prevent some of the mortality. But of course, there aren't really any good studies out there to look at this kind of question. So I think we really do need more ability, more funding, and more loosening of regulation on the research side to look at this. Other questions? If you want to take it, go. Yep. Okay.
I've loved this feisty debate for years with some of my friends about the pros and the cons. And just kind of having this conversation about medical versus recreational. I think that, you know, a lot of people who supported medical, you know, I think some people are really rethinking, you know, because of all of this that comes with medical, you know. I just wonder your opinion on, do you think that we should have maybe just gone for recreational? Because there's a part of me that thinks it wouldn't put doctors in these positions in the first place.
Yeah, you know, I'm still just at such a foundational level. I'm not sure I can answer that question at all. I just don't know. Yeah.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm a mental health professional, and it's a mix of art and science, and that's what I'm interested in, is where those two intersect. And seems I really appreciate what you had to say, because it's such an emotional issue, and I'm interested in where the science and the art intersect over this issue, because I get frustrated with the two. It feels like polarization, extremes. I wonder where we can come together. It seems like we're going to have to come together to do that research and find out what's false and what is true, and there has to be some listening. So that I also want to say thank you for doing this, because I think this is part of that.
Yeah.
So.
You know, what one of the things that drew me to psychiatry is a wonderful mix of every person that was asking for help in front of you. There was a biology and a psychology and a sociology and an environmental, and everyone, that just how that all mixes together into the problem that the individual is coming to you for. All of those things have to be addressed with every individual. That's the beauty of psychiatry, and it's the complexity of psychiatry as well.
Question down here.
Yes, if you're a psychiatrist and you know your patient has a medical marijuana card, they're taking marijuana, and how can you really treat them with other drugs for their other psychiatric conditions?
Yeah. I talked about the difference between prescribing and recommending. Well, there's no law that says I can't be very aggressive about not recommending. And for an individual with a mental illness, yeah, I mean, just from the evidence I've seen so far, it is very rare that any of the mental illnesses are going to be well treated by anything with THC in it. It's you just don't see it. And so I would work really, really hard and say you're working against your mental illness here.
Yeah. Okay, so I think that's going to wrap up our conference. Thank you very much for attending. Please give a warm round of applause for our speakers, Dr. Clancy, the William K. Warren Foundation, and the Laureate Institute for Brain Research. And thank you to TU for hosting.